study now through Hilfom Tristan Bio about how planets evolve.
Okay, thanks, Rem. And I'd like to just begin because I think I won't have time at the end of my talk, thanking the organizers, even though I didn't get my massage yet. And I got all dirty crawling into these caves yesterday. I think it was a really great school, and at least for me, I hope it was the same for you. So thank you, Ram and Dave, for that. And so today, I'd like to make a presentation both on, trying to understand, again, the physics of interior and going towards evolution and giving a little bit of results that have been presented. It's not a review, so I'm not going to provide you very the up-to-date results in all the different fields, but we'll try to see what's important behind, what are the important questions. Okay, so in the last talk we had seen that we could probe the interior of Jupiter. We had worked on equations of state. We had seen that when you compress the hydrogen molecule, you form metallic hydrogen because electrons become degenerate, so you give them a lot of energy, and that in that case you have a scaling between pressure and density, so that density is pressure is proportional to density to the power 5/3. So so that's the part that's really crucial to solve hydrostatic equilibrium. And I'm going to talk very briefly now about opacities, with the goal is to be able to solve the thermodynamic equation, which was, unfortunately, I don't have the whiteboard anymore. But so we had dT over dm is equal to dP over dm, basically times t over p nabla t. Okay, so that's an important equation. So basically nabla t is by definition d ln t over d okay, so I'll use that afterwards. Okay, so we want to solve that equation, and this nabla t here, it's just a pure definition, but it contains all the physics for heat transport. Depending on the process that's transporting your internal heat, nabla t will change, so that if you have a radiative equilibrium, we know that this nabla t will depend on the luminosity. If we have a convective environment, nabla t is set by the adiabatic gradient. So some preliminary remarks. If you have, I'm going to go very fast because it's basic stellar physics, but we're going to use these three definitions. So the pressure scale height, this is something very obvious, but so it's HP is equal to, so it's minus dr over dp times p, OK? Okay, so it's a height. So which is in the case of a spherical symmetry equal to P over rho G. And we've seen in the case of a polytropic relation, you can write that this is rho 1 over n divided by G. Okay, so what does it imply? G generally, when you go into the interior, doesn't change that much. So the pressure scale height will be roughly proportional to rho to a certain power. If we have an n equal 1 polytrope, basically it's rho. In Jupiter, or in hot Jupiters, even more, in the photosphere, we have pressures of around 1 bar. We have ideal gas, and you can very easily calculate that the corresponding density is very small. Even for a temperature of 100 K, you have a density of 10 minus 4 grams per cc. We have seen in the phase diagram for hydrogen that when we reach tens of megabars, the density, well, actually there was no plot of that exactly, but believe me on that, the density goes up to a few grams per cubic centimeters. So it means that the pressure scale height increases a lot as you go down, okay, by really orders of magnitude. Okay, and this is important because so if you imagine your interior, and this will be the case in any object from stars to planets, your pressure scale height will be much larger at the bottom than at the top. Okay, so it means that your convective motions generally will you will tend to mix things on larger distances, although there may be some complications in case there are some molecular weight gradients. Okay, so this is one first preliminary point that is important, and then I'd like to write this radiative gradient here. So the radiative gradient is the gradient. So it's again dlnt over dlnp that you would have if your planet was radiative. And the important thing is not the constant here; it's the it's these values. So I'm gonna use this proportionality factor. So it's proportional to the opacity, the pressure, the luminosity, and the mass that you're considering. Okay.
I want to get it in the camera.
Ah, okay. Thank you. The mass that you're considering and t to the fourth. So very. So what this tells you is that if you have a high luminosity to transport, you will have, so this is again dlnt over dlnp in a radiative environment, you will have you will need a temperature gradient that is more important than if you have a small luminosity. Similarly, if you have a high opacity, you will have also a larger temperature gradient. Conversely, if you have an isothermal structure, you're not transporting any luminosity. L would go to zero. What can we say? Well, we'll use that afterwards. And then we have this adiabatic gradient, which is written simply dLnt over dLnp at S constant. And the nice thing about using these dimensionless quantities is that this adiabatic gradient, which is defined only by the equation of state itself, so it's how temperatures varies with pressure along an adiabat, this quantity is something that is generally of order of 0.3, something like that. So it doesn't vary a lot. So if we're convective, we have these relations, but for the fluxes, but I'm not going to go into these details. But okay, so again, I'm going very fast with that. The important thing is to decide whether your environment is radiative or convective. You do that with this thought experiment in which you lift a bubble of material upward and you check whether its density is higher than the environment, in which case it will sink down again, or whether it's lighter than the environment, and then you have the convective instability. And you can show, and I'm not going to do that today, that this convective instability occurs when your radiative gradient is larger than the adiabatic gradient, plus a factor occurs that generally is ignored, and then it's called the Schwarzschild criterion. Okay, if we ignore that part. But if we have compositional gradients, you have to account for the fact that something that is at the bottom may be heavier than something at the top and will resist being mixed upward. Phi and delta are actually, they haven't been defined. They're derivatives of through the equation of state. It's a dLn rho over dLn p at t constant, I believe, and dLn rho over dLn mu at t constant as well. Okay, so they're functions of order unity, for our purposes. Okay, what we can say for Jupiter is that when you compare these gradients, you have, as I was saying, in the the atmosphere of Jupiter, so that's one bar, to the deep interior, you have an adiabatic gradient that is close to 0.3. So this is a log plot. The opacities change a lot inside the planet. I don't have time to show you the different opacities, but here you have absorption by methane and H2H2 collision-induced absorption. Deep down, you begin having more electrons. So that provides another very significant source of opacity, and you increase the pressure as well. The important question is whether this radiative gradient, so this is nabla rad, is larger than the adiabatic gradient or not. In some old calculations of opacities that I had done, actually I did my PhD partly on that, I had found that there may exist a little window in which heat, the opacity would be low because radiation would be able to escape in the visible because both methane, water, collision-induced absorption of hydrogen and helium have very low efficiencies in the visible. So the atmosphere could become transparent, and because you're calculating a mean opacity, this would occur in this region when the temperature of your radiation would be equal to 1,000, 2,000 Kelvin. But actually, in the mid-90s, after the discovery of brown dwarfs, it was discovered that brown dwarfs were emitting very little in the visible, and that we were missing an extra opacity source. And this opacity is due to alkali metals. Although they have very low abundances, they provide a high source of opacity. So nowadays, the idea is that Jupiter, Saturn, and planets which are not heavily irradiated are mostly convective. But however, if you are experts on opacities or have knowledge of that, it would be really nice to have these calculations redone with modern opacities, other approaches, and see, be able to check things. For example, if you assume a one-time solar enrichment inside Jupiter, you may have some radiative regions. So there are interesting problems behind. Okay, so so Jupiter should be mostly convective, and if we use mixing length theory, it's this figure. Sorry. Yes, that's for constant luminosity as a function of depth. In Jupiter, it doesn't matter much. Here we have but here we go to 10 to the 5 bars. So it's really a lot already for opacities, and there are huge problems related to how you calculate opacities at deep, at a kilobar level. We don't know how the wings behave. There are lots of problems. So that's why also it would be great to have this kind of work redone better. But for the luminosities, we're still quite high in the interior. So this is 10 to the 5 bars, so it's 0.1 megabar. I mean, it's stretching things in terms of how whether you can calculate opacities there. But yes. This was a calculation from 1999, and this is an updated calculation from the 2004 book, in which I included other things. I don't remember exactly, but maybe this is the 3-time solar effect that's providing more electrons there. So we moved. So basically, it's updated work. Okay, but I mean, it gives a feeling of the uncertainties there are here. I mean, I do not claim these calculations are extremely good. There are orders of magnitude calculations, really.
So asking the same question again, the no alkali compared to the red line.
So yes, no. Yes, this was an older work. But the no alkali should compare to the three times salt. I mean, to these other lines, and you have this big jump. It's an order of magnitude increase in the opacity, and this is because these alkali metals, although they are not very abundant, they absorb a lot, and importantly, they have these huge lines so that they block completely the visible spectrum. Okay. Yes. Oh yeah, I mean it's an important question. Certainly, when there is condensation, you have a lot of added opacity, so you would have the possibility to block radiation that way as well. But in these interiors, generally, what happens is that we believe droplets form rapidly and settle down, so we should have some layers that are relatively well defined, but you know, it's just hand waving. We don't know, so it's also something interesting to study. Yes, alkalis. I don't know about that, but the easiest answer is that we see them in brown dwarfs, and so at around same temperatures but in the atmosphere, so they should be there. Okay, properties of convection, very briefly. The important thing is that you can show that once you're convective, it's in a giant planet, because the density is quite high, generally. The amount of energy, internal energy, that in your blobs is large, and so you don't need to change the temperature gradient that much above the adiabatic value to transport the luminosity of your planet. So you write that nabla T, so the real temperature gradient that you have in your convective region, minus the adiabatic gradient, is of the order of 10 minus 3 times the effective temperature to the power 7/3, and it's a strong, there's a strong dependence to pressure. So basically, when you're convective in a giant planet, you're adiabatic. That's the simple way of thinking about it. Okay, in the Sun, for example, at the top of the convective zone of the Sun, you have important radiative effects, so that convection is not that efficient, so you lose heat by radiation during the convective process, and then you have what's called a super adiabatic gradient that is not negligible. The velocities for the motions are generally relatively small on average. So in a mixing length sense, you can show that at the surface you have typical velocities of meters per second, but they're of the order of centimeters per second down at the bottom of your planet. But there, near 1 bar, you have a pressure scale height that's of the order of 40 kilometers, whereas it's larger than 10,000 kilometers at the center. So you really have a, you know, your first scale height is really a fraction of your planet, a significant fraction of your planet. Okay, and then if you want to calculate the Rossby number, so to see whether rotation will play an important role, it's of order unity at the surface, but deep down, it becomes very small, and this is because you have this huge scale height, this slow motion, and so rotation has time to really affect these motions. Okay, so just we will keep that. Yes.
So is the reason the velocity increases so much over the radius of the planet just can you think of it just as you have a constant KZZ in the convective zone, a constant basically effective diffusivity of the convection, and your scale height is just increasing, and that's why your scale height is decreasing, and that's why your velocities are increasing. To think of the velocities as like KZZ divided by h, or is there something else going on?
I don't know. It's not. You're not calculating that as a diffusion process. You're really looking at the acceleration of your bubbles. You know, you calculate the buoyancy acceleration, of course, the pressure scale height plays an important role. And you're assuming that your bubbles are dissolving into the environment. But yeah, I don't think you can think of it as a constant KZZ. And actually, KZZ should not be constant. So referring to the turbulent diffusion due to any motion, actually. I think it's something that is more useful in a radiative region, in a convective region. I mean, you're mixing so rapidly that generally it's not used.
Yes. The velocity is changing with depth is just simply changing density. Okay. I mean, I know it's only inverse cube root, but you're changing the density by four orders of magnitude. The other thing that matters is that the temperature scale height actually becomes larger than the planet when you deep down. And when you look at, I mean, theory of convection is actually imperfect, and nobody quite knows exactly how to do it. But if you believed that the actual scale of the motions is like a scale height, then there's an additional inefficiency that comes from that. Whereas near the surface, you can use the entire scale height or maybe more for your convective motion.
Okay, so now I'm going to give you briefly some results on, the principle behind some results for the internal structure of our giant planets. Basically, okay, you remember we have these observations and the gravitational moments that have been measured for Jupiter and Saturn, so we have to use that to infer what is the internal density profile. We have atmospheric temperatures, which are measured to be of the order of 165K for Jupiter, 135 for Saturn. And then atmospheric abundances in Jupiter and in Saturn indicate that there is less helium there than than there was in the Sun. So we have to account for this. And generally, the way we do that is in the spirit of the Jeffries model, having a structure in which is divided into a region which is helium poor here, another region which is helium rich, and something that is left at the center, which is a core. And we don't know whether it's made of ice or rocks. The only thing is it has to be denser than hydrogen and helium. And as we've seen, the phase separation of helium into hydrogen occurs near the transition from molecular to metallic hydrogen. So a convenient simplification has been to say that, okay, this is where we put the transition, okay? It could be exactly at the molecular to metallic hydrogen, it could be elsewhere. And we further simplify things by assuming that this transition is very narrow. Okay, so it's a discontinuity. So it's clearly a simplification in regard to the present phase diagrams, but so far this is, I mean, all the models have assumed that. Yes? Metallic hydrogen? Okay, this is because if you look for Jupiter, we had a phase diagram which was you had pressure here and temperature, but this was linear, so you had a temperature pressure profile like this, and your phase transition region was like that, and this was say 1 megabar. Okay, and around 2 megabars here, say. Well, this is a small region inside Jupiter. So if the phase diagram is like that, it's okay to assume that this can be approximated as a discontinuity. For Saturn, if we have a profile that is like that, you are immiscible all the way to the center, it becomes a real problem. So this is something we'll have to change in future models, very probably. Okay, so then you plug all these observational constraints into a model which solves the hydrostatic equations with rotation, and you compare your observations to your models until you get the correct values, and then you retrieve the mass of the rock ice core and the compositions in the metallic and molecular hydrogen. So generally, you do that by minimizing this kind of function, and you get these kind of solutions. So we'll look just at the top plot for Jupiter. So this is relatively old work, but it shows the sources of uncertainties in the solution. So those are our solutions. So in terms of mass of the core and total mass of heavy elements in your planet, and you can see, depending on two equations of state that were available at the time, I won't enter the details, you find these different solutions. Okay, so generally a relatively small core mass, less than 10 Earth masses, or even no core mass for Jupiter. And the uncertainties are related to the temperature gradient in your interior. I was using the possible presence of a radiative region in that case. The amount of differential rotation in the interior, because it perturbs your gravitational moments, and the uncertainty on the gravitational moments themselves. So you can do that for Saturn as well, and in 1999, I found that, Saturn would have a core less than about 18 Earth masses, could not be zero, but now we're finding solutions also going all the way to zero. It depends whether you put the transition here or deeper down. There are all these parameters you can play with. Yes? So, as I said just before, those correspond to the uncertainties of your constraints. Okay, so you have an observational uncertainty on J4, and so it explains the spread of models that way. And so it's a way to see the importance of the different uncertainties. In that case, the value of J4 for Saturn was quite uncertain. Now it has been improved, but we still have significant uncertainties due to the that we don't know whether Saturn rotates as a solid body or with differential rotation in the interior. So this diagram has evolved. So I'm showing more modern results, although those are not even the last ones. But basically, we have still a spread of solutions between large core masses and small amount of heavy elements in the envelope, and small core masses and large amounts of heavy elements in the envelope, depending on the equations of state that have been chosen and depending on the assumptions that the authors have made, whether you assume that heavy elements should be mixed throughout, or whether you assume there's also a discontinuity, will change the results. So it's something that is there is still work going on, and we hope with Juno to be able to clarify that. There's also a complication that is related to the possible presence of semi-convection. If there is semi-convection, the mass of heavy elements in the envelope could go up. We'll come back to that. Yes?
Maybe it's further on. So far, I've seen constraints from the entropy curve, and especially the pressure profile. In earlier figures, you had
yes.
For the first logarithm range of pressure, and this you have measurements for.
Actually, the entry probe went to 22 bars. Okay, but this is just skin deep in Jupiter. So I'm using I'm using the temperature at 1 bar. And with plus or minus 5 Kelvin of uncertainty. I could use, you're right, the boundary condition at 22 bars with the temperature measured by the probe, but it wouldn't make a difference because it's close to adiabatic, and this is the uncertainty behind that is included is in this plus or minus 5 Kelvin. So you're right. I mean, it's we should use all the information, but it amounts to the same thing. Okay. Yes. Oh, sorry. Yes, this is not easy to explain because it really depends on the behavior of the equation of state in the megabar region, which is really important, and the weighting function on J2 and J4. How they enter into that, but we're finding this kind of trend. I cannot. Yes. Of course, semi-convection will play a role because it affects your whole solution. But basically, you're changing the temperature profile, and so to first order, it's mostly the amount of heavy elements that you're changing in order to have the same mean density, because you're having a higher temperature. But of course, you have to. I mean, it's a complex problem. So you cannot do that by hand waving arguments. You have to do the real calculation. So with Juno, we're hoping to go from there to there. So and two important parameters are understanding internal rotation in the planet and constraining the abundance of water, water being such an important element in the planet. So assuming three-layer models like that, we could be able to determine a rather precise solution. But the issue now is that models are becoming more complex as we're understanding more things about convection and mixing. And so we will see what we're able to derive with Juno. The interesting thing is that we will have very, very accurate information on the gravity field and the magnetic field of the planet. And is constraint on the water abundance. So this is something that will be great for the next generation of models of Jupiter and Saturn. And this is really important because, you know, having this huge uncertainty on the mass of heavy elements in Jupiter, you know, to understand the origin of the solar system, it's a huge uncertainty. Imagine we could have made tens of Earths in the solar system, or not. So, this is important. So, basically, this is a kind of structure in the framework of these three-layer models that we can draw. There has been lots of new results, especially for Uranus and Neptune. Ravit has worked on that with also Nadine Nettleman. So I'm not showing those in this plot, but it's to give you an idea. Okay. Could we have a very different interior structure? It's possible. Dave had put... it's been now 30 years already, this very nice review where he compared the conventional model to maybe a more realistic model in which you would have some compositional layering with helium raindrops and something more complicated. And indeed, people like Leconte and Chabrier have claim that maybe you have a compositional gradient in the all the envelope so that you have a nabla mu that appears there and that changes your convection very significantly. So in that case, what could happen is that you could have the so-called double diffusive convection in which instead of having nabla T, which is equal to the adiabatic gradient, you have something which is much steeper because you form layers in which heat is transported by conduction where you have a big compositional gradient, and so this is less efficient. So it would make the central temperature of Jupiter much higher, and they quoted even, I think, 60,000 K. It's a very interesting problem and a very important question. I think that with realistic models, you tend to homogenize a large fraction of the envelope, so you shouldn't get this tremendous an effect. However, it is definitely something that is important to study. Another aspect is that, and then there's this with seismology in the rings of Saturn that I mentioned in my first lecture, you have, in order to explain the frequencies that you observed and their splitting, Jim Fuller came up with one explanation. We don't know whether it's the only one or whether there are others, but in which you would indeed have a quite different structure for Saturn's interior, in which you have an inner core and then a stable outer core in which you develop G-modes. They interact with these pressure waves over there, and then you're able to explain the splitting of the frequencies. So for interior models, it's really important. It gives us some very significant constraints. Of course, Jim used a very simple model with polytropes, so it's just a preliminary solution, and it definitely should be integrated into future models of Saturn. Something I wanted to mention is that when you form a planet, you have a lot of energy. So you have this GM square over R. Even if you have a central core that's 20 Earth masses, it may be possible if you use 10% of the convective energy to mix it upward. It's 10% is just a number thrown like this, so it could be 10 minus 4, the efficiency. I don't think it could be much larger than 10%. But energetically, you can see that during the lifetime of Jupiter, you could erode the core. For Saturn, it's much less efficient because Saturn's envelope is comparatively much smaller. So it's not something you can do. But it has been shown from statistical physics and these ab initio calculations that indeed, a lot of elements like water and silicates are miscible into metallic hydrogen. So you're able effectively to dissolve them. They will dissolve into a metallic hydrogen. So the problem is mostly hydrodynamical. Do we have these compositional layering preventing the upward mixing, or is it efficient enough so that you can maybe scoop up material and get and homogenize the interior.
Convective energy, you don't mean the energy in the convective flow at any given moment. You mean the energy that the convection is giving out from the center of the light line.
Yes. That's correct. That's using actually the energy in the convective cell in the motion of the first convective cell, but that corresponds to actually a fraction of Jupiter's total, significant fraction of Jupiter's total luminosity. Okay. Yes.
There is, I believe, an unsolved problem connected to this, which is: can you think about the mixing process locally or globally? By locally, I mean you take the heat flux at a given location. This is the way you would do it in the Earth's oceans, the way they do it in the Earth's oceans, the mixing salinity. You take the heat flow, the convective vigor at a given location, and take some fraction of that and do gravitational work. Or do you say that the large-scale motions can benefit from what's happening much higher up? And the convection is non-local, so there is an issue about how much efficiency you really have.
Yeah, absolutely.
The heat flow deep down is actually quite small because it's due to the cooling of what's beneath you, and so it actually goes to zero if you go to the center of the planet if it's just cooling.
Yeah. Absolutely. Okay. Well, that's a good point. It will affect the evolution of the planet because effectively you're using a fraction of the luminosity to redistribute your element upwards. So it's something that you're not having in the atmosphere.
Yeah, you will get a slight reduction of luminosity. So in the case of Jupiter, it's probably in the noise.
But
in case of Saturn, it's less obvious.
Okay, so now let's switch gears a little bit and talk about evolution. Okay, again, I'll have to go fast. And just wanted to mention that the evolution of planets and stars in general, of giant planets and stars, is driven by the Virial theorem, which is an integral of the hydrostatic equilibrium. You can calculate the total energy as being the gravitational energy plus the internal energy that you give to your star. And you write this equation that the luminosity is equal to minus the derivative of the total energy over time. And you can show that the luminosity is a function of the derivative of the gravitational energy. And this factor psi here is defined by 3p over mu rho, and it's something that's related to the equation of state. You can use the relations in my previous lecture to convince yourself that the internal energy is indeed that this factor psi that relates internal energy to pressure and density is 2 for a monoatomic perfect gas, and it's also 2 for degenerate electron gas. And if you average that out over the entire object, you can write this kind of relation. And okay, then you can note that for giant planets, the internal energy, which it's essentially the energy of the electron gas plus the energy of the ions, is essentially the energy of the electron gas because of degeneracy. And then you can show, and actually I can go fast there because Rem, Rem did a nice calculation of that. With a different approach, you can show that the energy of your electron gas is proportional to the density to the 2/3. The gravitational energy is, of course, proportional to the rho to the 1/3. And that implies that when you contract your fully degenerate electron gas, in fact, the only luminosity you can get is from the cooling of the ions, and so a decrease of the temperature of your planet. So basically, contrary to stars, in giant planets, because they resist compression, you're not using the entire gravitational energy reservoir for your cooling. Is just a small fraction of that. So you can write that the luminosity is proportional to this eta factor, gm square over r, multiplied by time. If you have a perfect gas, you can show very simply through the Virial theorem that this is 1/2. Okay, and it's you have the standard Kelvin-Helmholtz timescale. But for a degenerate planet, this is smaller, and eta is of the order of 3% only. So really the luminosity, as Rem showed, is due to the cooling of the ions. So this is how luminosity behaves at 1 billion year, or at 5 billion years as a function of mass of your solar composition object. OK. okay, you can see that it's indeed a strong function of mass. It's not exactly to the m square because there's the radius changes in these models. And you can use the same approach for many objects from stars to planets. And this is a diagram showing luminosities as a function of time. And this is log luminosity, okay? So this would be the sun here. And those are for, so this is Saturn all the way up to 0.2 solar mass star. So what's important is all of them are assumed to start with a high luminosity. They contract, and for planets, the luminosities always decrease. For brown dwarfs, they also always decrease. You have this bump. You know why it's due? What causes this bump for brown dwarfs? The deuterium. Yeah, it's exactly deuterium burning here, also for stars. But stars, they end up on a main sequence in which you have an equilibrium. And in that case, our evolution equation remember, dl over dm is equal to epsilon dot minus t ds over dt. For stars, because of hydrogen burning, these terms becomes important. So these terms, which is the cooling and the contraction, goes to zero. And so you have this equilibrium. For brown dwarfs, you never get there, even if you burn hydrogen, and so you have the same physics as for planets. So this is another diagram, which is a little bit more complicated, but I'm going to go quickly through that, which shows as a function of effective temperature, so at the in the photosphere of your object, take that as the temperature at the photosphere, the size of your object. Those are stars in that case. So 0.07 solar mass star, and going all the way to Saturn here. And evolution is that way. So what happens is that at the beginning, you have you start from an arbitrary initial condition. You have some material in which is closer to ideal gas, in which thermal effects are important. So you have a significant contraction. You heat, have a large luminosity, and after reaching a certain point, actually when degeneracy begins to set in, you stop heating the interior, and you will cool the interior, and your luminosity will slowly decrease. Okay? So something to remember. Yes. Yes. Actually, it's a well-known result for stars that at the beginning, at the very beginning of the evolution, you start from a very extended sphere of gas, you have where you have almost ideal gas equation of state, and when you contract, it heats up. Okay, and that's how for the sun you reach at some point the hydrogen burning. You reach 15 million Kelvin. You burn hydrogen, and for a star you stay there, and you heat the interior, and then you have thermonuclear reactions. For brown dwarfs and giant planets.
You mean in the sense that the temperature is going up.
Yes.
The entropy is still going down. It's cooling in the sense that it loses energy. So the entropy of the interior is going down all the time throughout this scale.
Yes.
So when he's saying you heat up, it means that the temperature is going up.
Yes.
You can still call it cooling in the sense that the entropy is going down.
Yes.
So it gives energy to the outside. That's what
yes, absolutely. And you have a change of behavior when the equation of state changes, and then the degeneracy sets in, and then in order to supply the luminosity, you need to cool the ions, and then you have a change in behavior. So what Rehm said can be seen in this simple analytical cooling model that was applied to Jupiter, and which simply integrates this equation, and in which the dS over dt, so we're For stars on the Premain sequence, we don't have this term, it's not important. And this TdS over dt, you can write it as, so in that case, it's not close to zero. You can write it as Cv dt over dt minus this gamma t over rho, d rho over dt. Okay, so you have one component is one component is the temperature, and one component is the mean density. So you can you're always losing entropy, as Rehm said, but for some time you can have that positive as long as this is negative, so that the whole, sorry, there's a minus here, so that the whole thing is negative. Okay, and once this term becomes too small, then you need to cool the interior. So basically what this semi-analytical model does is that it takes a temperature profile, assumes you have an adiabatic structure, okay, so you have so once you define the temperature in the outside, you can calculate the temperature in the whole interior. And then you simply integrate this equation here, okay? Okay, so this is simply that. And in order to solve the problem, you have to assume that your one bar temperature or your photospheric temperature is a function of effective temperature and gravity to a certain power. So I'm going to write that here. So T1 is equal to K T E to power A G minus B. Okay. So here, in essence, what is happening? You have Okay, if here you have log P, and this is log T, you're saying, okay, I have an atmospheric boundary condition, which is here, and which defines my internal temperature profile. And in order to go to the next to have a different physical temperature, I have to calculate how long I need to cool with the luminosity that corresponds to this effective temperature to get to that point. And then I do that. So since I know this relation from that, and I can link luminosity, remember that L equals 4 pi r squared sigma T e to the fourth. Since I can link luminosity with physical temperature in the atmosphere, I can solve this equation. And doing that, you show that delta T needed to cool from this state with effective temperature 1, TF1, and this is, sorry, my writing is terrible, I apologize. This is TF2, so you have delta T. This delta T is proportional to a certain factor, and then T effective temperature to the power A minus 4, okay, and you make the ratio, the difference of that. A is of the order unity, so we generally have a 1 bar temperature or temperature at a given pressure of the order of the effective temperature of the effective temperature. So this is T effective minus 3. So as Rem assumed the other day, that it's not sensitive to initial conditions is indeed true. You have because it's a very strong function of effective temperature, it means that most of the time is spent to cool at the last stages. Okay, you take more and more time to cool your planet. You can even with that solution include the irradiation and show that it will slow your cooling, and it slows your cooling because your boundary condition becomes a little bit different. So with that assumption, you have a perturbation to this this equation. Okay. Yes.
So, I just don't understand why do you like the boundary condition in a particular way, and why do you maybe like to lock small t. Can you explain more on what makes those assumptions?
Generally, d log g dt, when you have a planet that is degenerate, becomes very small because for the reason I showed previously, because the energy of the electron gas is so important, so you just have cooling from the ions and the radius evolution is small. So, but the easier thing is to do that a posteriori, and here is the evolution of Jupiter and Saturn. This was a calculation done a long time ago. It shows as a function of time both the radius effective temperature, 1 bar temperature. And you can see that the radius changes very little, actually. So it's hard to change the radius of a planet over, so this is 4 billion years here, and this is in log T. Okay, so okay, and then with the helium phase separation, you can prolong Saturn's evolution, explain its age, but I'm not going to go through that. So let's go now in the last 20 minutes towards hot Jupiters and to try to see what's happening there. So in the case of hot Jupiters, we have again the same kind of, exactly the same relation. So the effective temperature of an irradiated planet, which will be defined by this sum, where this is the part of the irradiation luminosity that has been absorbed in the atmosphere. You use that to calculate the equilibrium temperature. And the only difference with Jupiter is that this equilibrium temperature, instead of being 100 K or so, is 10 times larger. So in terms of flux, this is 10 to the 4 times larger. So you're really dominated by irradiation in that case. So for Jupiter, you can trace the evolution in the following way. It's the same kind of diagram as I showed for planets and brown dwarfs, but in this case it's an HR diagram as for stars for a one Jupiter mass planet. Here lies the evolution track for a fully convective adiabatic planet that is not irradiated. So Jupiter would lie on this plot and would evolve from an extended object down to something that has the size of Jupiter and luminosity of Jupiter today. Okay, so these dotted lines, I don't know if you can see them, those are lines of constant radii. So this is one Jupiter radius, so you have 2, 4, 8, 16. Of course, numerically, you can do whatever you want. And there are hydrostatic solutions down this line. Here, this is the Hayashi forbidden region for planets. That is, unless you have semi-convection, you cannot have planets lying there because you would need to have a super adiabatic gradient. So if there's no semi-convection, you cannot have planets there. So the question when 51 PEG was discovered was how can we explain that it's present? What is its size? Will it survive? And so this plot was very useful because you can relate the equilibrium temperature in the atmosphere to your evolution track. And 51 PEG was is at 0.05 AU, so you would have an equilibrium temperature of around 1300 K. And so it means that your planet cannot go right of this line. Okay, so what does it do? There's no singularity, so you have to in fact continue the evolution. If you would stay on this line and stop here, okay, you would have a planet that is hotter in the interior and cooler in the outside, and yet it would not transfer heat, right? Okay, so it's not possible. So what happens? What has to happen? Well, this line is assuming you have a fully convective interior, and it's adiabatic. So, no, it's not that. Look at this here. If you have, if you go here, okay, and suddenly you stop because you cannot cool your atmosphere below this temperature, what will happen is that this term here, dL over dm equal minus TdS over dt, will drop, right? Okay, because you're stopping, so your dt becomes infinite, so you're not evolving anymore. So it means that the luminosity, intrinsic luminosity, what would it do in that case? Goes to zero, exactly. If it goes to zero, what happens to the radiative gradient? it's isothermal. So it goes to zero here, right? Luminosity goes to zero. So if your radiative gradient goes to zero, what happens for your internal structure? Remember, we have assumed it's fully convective. So it's no longer fully convective. So in fact, you're developing a radiative region, and that's how you're moving out, and you're continuing the contraction. So as Rehm showed, here, if you stop, if you heat your atmosphere here, your planet will not be able to go there. So instead, it will still cool and contract, but it will form a radiative region that will develop. And this is something you can see here, where the radiative region evolves. So this is time in log T, pressure. So you have central pressure here, and initial contraction of the planet, and growth of the radiative zone. Another way to see it, it's like this plot, but in terms of entropy, you're going down in entropy on a fully convective with a fully convective planet, and there. Your atmosphere is forced to be at a certain entropy, so you will develop this radiative region, which corresponds to a decrease in entropy as you go down into the planet. So this is the same kind of plot, but with colors and with temperatures, showing the development of the radiative zone. Okay, so this is what happens. Then, let's try to see what happens with the sizes of these planets. When HD209 was discovered, we had a wrong atmospheric model, and in fact, it was too hot. So we predicted the radius correctly. Before the observation, but actually then we reworked our models, and we found that in fact our atmosphere was too warm, and that with a normal an improved atmosphere, the observed radius was too large by a rather significant amount of order 10%. And as has been explained earlier, I mean 10% on radius for a planet is hard to get. So I will term this the radius anomaly problem. And let's see what's happening to the internal structure of our planets. So in the hot versus cold atmospheric models, those are two solutions that match the radius of HD209. So it's a log P is increasing this way, so you're going into the interior, and this is temperature. So you can see here in the hot model, we have this temperature profile. So a region which is isothermal, more or less, till 100 bars in that case. And then we're on that slope. And we have a convective radiative transition at this point. So this region is radiative and this is convective. If you use a different atmospheric model that's colder, you can get the same kind of solution to match the observed radius. But it looks a bit different. The radiative convective boundary has moved up to lower pressures. And of course, the boundary condition is at lower temperature. So in order to, so you can see that this part does nothing for the radius. It's really the radius of your planet sets the entropy in the interior, and so it sets this adiabatic relation here. Okay, it's exactly the same for the two cases. What has changed are the ages. Here it's 0.1 billion years, and here it's 5 billion years. So what is changed between these two models in terms of the parameters we have here? Do you know what's the we have a different atmospheric model, so the physical temperature is different. No one. So how can we move? You see, in order to have to explain the size and to be on the same adiabat, here I had to force my planet to be convective all the way to 100 bars. In order to do so, because I have a lower temperature in the interior, I had to crank up my luminosity. Okay? And to crank up my luminosity is the same thing as having a very young model. Okay? Because I'm contracting. Okay? So, it shows, and this has been nicely also explained by Aras and Bilstein, that you have, I mean, this region controls the energy that's going out of your planet. You have this isothermal region, and the radius that you measure really sets the internal entropy of your planet. I think this is something to remember. Okay. Let's see what... okay. So there are some complications to these models that you can play with. I'm going to do that very briefly. For example, if you have a day-night temperature difference, then you have we're using 1D models. You can do this thought experiment where you cut your planet in half, let one half evolve with a certain equilibrium temperature, the other half evolve with another equilibrium temperature. And but at each time step, you're forcing your planet to exchange its heat and to exchange its entropy. So effectively, you need to have a day-to-night side flux coming from the interior. This is a rather extreme model in which you would assume that the two hemispheres are decoupled and they exchange through the center. But it's interesting to see how this would affect the cooling of your planet. So you would have a luminosity for the day side that is much smaller at the same age here than on the night side, because your night side is cooler, so you can radiate much more easily. And in that case, you find that the problem is more acute in the sense that your heat is escaping from the cold regions, and so your radius is even smaller than what you want to achieve. There was a nice paper last year by Emily Rauscher and Adam showing this effect, but with a GCM. And actually, what's interesting in that case is that they're finding that the day-to-night temperature difference is not so important, because with zonal winds, you're going to average out the internal temperature quite easily, even if you have a very slow rotation inside. But what because of the structure of the models, it's difficult for these winds to exchange heat meridionally, and so you have poles which are much colder than the outside, and in that case they find that you can have a 10 to 50% faster cooling. So it's a confirmation of this effect. So we need an extra source of energy, and you can show so that this can be explained by using again the same energy conservation equation, but in that case adding this epsilon dot that is used for SARs, for thermonuclear reactions, but you have to assume that there's an other process that's dissipating energy deep into the planet, and so this is something that we did with Adam, and showed that if you dissipate about 1% of the energy that you receive at the center of the planet, you can stop the evolution. If you dissipate it higher up in the planet, generally you need more energy. This M0 here equal 1 corresponds to the center, so center deep position. This corresponds to a very high up in the atmosphere. And so it's a way to explain the observations. The structure of your planet, which will look different. So if you deposit heat very deep down, this is this black curve, okay, then you can force the structure to be like that. If you're depositing higher up, effectively, it's the same as making the atmosphere very hot, but you need to transport heat downward. Okay, so this radius anomaly is a common problem that has stayed with us, since its discovery, and actually Peter Bodenheimer was the first to point that out just before our paper with Adam. And this is a plot, it's not up to date, that shows sample of hot Jupiters showing the value of the radius anomaly. So when it's when it's positive, it means that even with just hydrogen and helium, we don't have a radius that's large enough, so we're missing some physics. When it's negative, we can always invoke heavy elements and the core to explain the small size. So the claim, or my claim, is that probably, and maybe it's not true for all the planets, but we can assume that the same mechanism is applying to all these planets, and see what kind of solutions we get. But it's important to try to understand what kind of process we can have. Okay, so basically you have a binding energy for Hg209 that's of the order of 10 to the 43 ergs, and you have three possibilities to explain the large sizes. One is simply to slow the cooling. Okay, you're starting from an extended sphere and slow the cooling, for example, increase the opacities in the interior. So if you invoke a lot of clouds, for example, different opacity structure in the interior, maybe you can do that. Then the other possibility that has received a lot of attention is to transport irradiation energy deep. So you can't do that with the photons because they're absorbed too rapidly. So you need to invoke that there's some kinetic energy going down. And so you're effectively using the stellar photons and dissipating them deeper down. But since there's a 10 to the 4 ratio between the irradiated energy and the intrinsic luminosity of your planet, it's a process that is rather efficient. So you get these 10 to the 43 ergs if you integrate the stellar radiation luminosity for 1 million years. And the third possibility that was invoked first, for example, by Peter Bodenheimer, is to tap from the orbital energy reservoir. So you have two kinds of reservoirs. One is in the orbit, around 10 to the 44 ergs, and in the spin of the planet, but you see that it's at least an order of magnitude smaller than that. So yes, you can use that, but it's a one-time process, so you cannot do that for long. So I will have to conclude. There are lots of works on these two aspects, but I think the most promising one is to use irradiation energy transported deep. So I'm going to go fast on that. So you can transport it downward because you're adding kinetic energy in your atmosphere, and you can show that it goes down. So you could have a slightly asynchronous rotation, playing with tides also. You could have ohmic dissipation. So Sivan has a poster on that. That's actually coupled to the other mechanism because you're coupling winds with a magnetic field that creates a current if you're ionized. So this is something that works well, and it can explain the sizes. For the evolution with tides, you can explain an increase in sizes, but generally it's for a short time, so you need to time things too much to explain the observations. Okay, so I'm just going to show a last result compared. So it's showing the, in order to explain, so that's a plot showing the radius anomaly as a function of equilibrium temperature with a recent ensemble of planets. This is work done by Mathieu Havel, and you see that there's a clear correlation with equilibrium temperature. But maybe a more interesting plot for the discussion is that one. So it's the as a function of effective temperature. You know, I said that you could use 1% of the stellar irradiation to explain the sizes of the largest planets, more or less. This plot shows for each planet as a function of equilibrium temperature exactly how much is this fraction that you need. So you can see that these dots are zero here, but that you increase in that case. So maybe ohmic dissipation with ionized material plays a role, but we have to explain also these planets. Some of these planets are very highly inflated, and we yet don't understand why is that. So I'm gonna have to finish with that, and these are my conclusions, and sorry for being a little late. Thank you.
Couple of questions. For that last plot, were you assuming that all the energy was dissipated in the convective interior to get the fractions?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, it's simpler, and we use same assumptions for all the planets. Although it's very likely incorrect, as your models show.
So let's assume we have the same inflation mechanism. So
yes.
We would naively expect that at the same temperature, if they have the same composition, we will roughly have the same radius anomaly. But I think many people say, and you said, that we can explain the spread at the same temperature with a more massive core or some heavier composition.
Yes.
So how much more massive of a core will we need to explain the spread in the LED?
It depends a lot. What is interesting is that we're seeing, it's a little bit difficult to see, but there's a significant correlation there behind, that the radius anomaly is correlated with the metallicity of the star. So it tells me that there is a process that puts more heavy elements into planets that orbit more metal-rich stars. But there's a spread because you have different masses and all that. In terms of the masses, this is an old plot that I skipped, but thanks for allowing me to come back to that. You need a spread of core masses and from 0 to 100 Earth masses in this plot, and sometimes there are some crazy objects which are so dense that you need hundreds of Earth masses. So because now we have a variety of objects, I cannot tell whether our formation models are completely off and we indeed are able to form these crazy objects, or whether we have a rare configuration in which we have an alignment of a star that we haven't seen, and so that it's the observational interpretation that is incorrect. But in some cases, we need very large core masses. So it's a case, for example, of Corot 20b, which needs more than a few hundred Earth masses in its interior.
This was a rather minor point in your talk, but you showed an HR diagram for planets.
Yes.
I found this concept very interesting and new, rather new for me. Can you elaborate on that, what you expect? Would there be a main sequence for planets? What is expected to be seen there once we have data?
yes. Actually, it depends. We're not expecting a main sequence for planets, so except if you have a lot of dissipation. Sorry, I'm going to try to find this. Okay, it was here. These planets are contracting, so. Yes, you would not expect to have an equilibrium solution, except if dissipation occurs deep enough in the interior, and in that case, you can actually stop contraction because you have an epsilon dot term here, and so this goes to zero, and for example, in Sivan poster, you can see that because you're able to dissipate in your model deep enough, and so you're completely stopping the evolution, right? But observationally, I don't know how we could put points on there. The effective temperature will be is easy to define, but for planets, their intrinsic luminosity is a difficult quantity to get. You need to look at secondary eclipses and all that. But maybe that could be something interesting to be done.
Okay, Tristan.
Okay.
So, thanks. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And it's lunch for everybody and a short massage for.
Thank you.